time arrived for Elizabeth to have her child, she gave birth to a son. Her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown his great mercy towards her, and they rejoiced with her. When they came on the eighth day to circumcise the child, they were going to call him Zechariah after his father. But his mother said in reply, "No, he will be called John." But they answered her, "There is no one among your relatives who has this name." So they made signs asking their father what he wished to be called. He asked for a tablet and wrote, "John is his name." And they were amazed. Immediately his mouth was open and his tongue free, and he spoke, blessing God. Then fear came upon all their neighbors. And all these matters were discussed throughout the hill country of Judea. All those who heard these things took them to heart, saying, "What then will this child be? For surely the hand of the Lord was with him." The child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the desert until the day of his manifestation to Israel. My brothers and sisters, this is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Part deep within each one of us that keeps telling us, I'm not worthy. And we need to be humble. And when we see, when we look at the life of St. John the Baptist, he had a birth narrative too, and then he died because of some, how do you call it, inappropriate, or shall I say, foolish favor. And then he says his head got cut off. But when we look at his life, proclaiming Jesus and paving the way for his coming, he was very effective. Why? Because he was very humble. He never wanted to take what did not belong to him. First and foremost, the virtue of humility is like a child of justice. Somehow, you don't take what doesn't belong to you. And so you do what is asked of you, and you don't claim what is not yours. So that's the first one. The first reading tells us that God will make us all alike to the mission. That's also a very powerful characteristic of St. John the Baptist. He was alive. See, every one of us loves the full moon. Right? When it's full moon, very bright, and it's very beautiful, especially when we have the big blue moon. And we're just happy when we see the full moon. And we adore it. We adore its brightness and its beauty. But everybody knows also that the light that it has doesn't belong to it. The moon doesn't own its light. It's a reflection of the sun. And that is how John the Baptist did his ministry and lived his life. All along, he knew. Of course, he was the light. He answered to the call to prepare the way for Jesus Christ. But all along, he knew also that even if I shine, John 3:30, I must decrease. So he must increase. He knew all along that I'm just a man. I may be shining, I may be popular, I may have apostles, but there's one much greater than me, the Son, who is Jesus Christ. And what is actually happening when we have Jesus Christ as our light? What effects this light has? You see, when we have a light, for example, a lamp or a LED flashlight, and we enter a very dark room, then we turn on the light, we begin to see what's around us. See, the light does not create what's inside the room, but the light enables us to see what's inside. And that is how the light of Jesus Christ affects us. Jesus Christ no longer creates us, but we need to be enlightened so we can see what is inside. So when we accept Jesus Christ as our light, we begin to see what is inside of us. We begin to see the beautiful things, of course, the beautiful things in the room. But also we begin to see things that need to be fixed. Okay? Things that need repair. Or some ugly parts of the room, maybe cobwebs. And that is how we appreciate and we treasure Jesus Christ as the light coming into our lives. Now, becoming the light of the nation is the same. When we become humble people, we allow Jesus to enlighten what is inside us. We allow Jesus to accept everything that we are, especially the things that are the interior things. And that is a very beautiful experience. And we become effective, we become loving, we become a real Christian brother and sister when with other people we also allow them to see what's inside. You see, that's how we become the light of the nations. John the Cross showed us, no, sorry, not John the Cross, John the Baptist. John the Baptist showed us that we have to be humble. And that's a very beautiful experience that is an experience or a realization that is empowering. We are able to carry out the mission because, first and foremost, we are able to accept Jesus as the light of our life. We allow Him to enlighten, to see the positive and the negative in each one of us, especially in the deepest recesses of our hearts or interior, which allows us to say, I am not worthy. There's another thing very close to being humble. You see, virtues grow together. You cannot say, I will just be loving, but I won't be patient. That's impossible. Virtues, if you have the virtues, some virtues are weak, and some virtues are strong. But when we work on the stronger virtues, somehow we pull up all the other virtues so they can grow together. That's how the virtues are embedded into our soul, into our character. They grow together. And with humility allows us to love truly. See, when we look at, again, John the Baptist, even unto death, even with all his sacrifices and difficulties, being in prison and everything, it won't matter because when we are humble, we have greater capacity for love. Again, my favorite woman saint, Teresa of Avila, said, what is humility? And she said, humildad es andar en verdad. Humility is nothing else but walking in truth. If we can walk in truth, then we become humble people. And that humility is actually what enables us or gives us the capacity to love more. It's very obvious in the person of St. John the Baptist. He was walking along in truth. That I'm here, sent to prepare the way of the Lord. I'm not the Lord. John the Baptist knew he wasn't God, but he was very lucky to introduce the coming of Jesus Christ and his definitive mission. And so when we celebrate, my dear brothers and sisters, this feast of St. John the Baptist, we are reminded that, yes, we are called to be the light of the world, like the moon. We owe everything to the sun. We owe everything to Jesus Christ. But still, we have to work on it and say, allowing Jesus Christ to come into our lives so that I may be humble. And so that by becoming humble also, I can be a very loving person. Even prepared and ready to die for our love. See, when we are humble, sacrifices come easy. When we are humble, we don't mind doing the extra mile, okay, extra work, because that empowers us to be more loving. And when we stay humble, we are more certain that we are not doing the right things for the wrong reason. Because if we lose this humility, many times we begin to do things. We think they might be beautiful things, but maybe we're doing it for the wrong reason. Maybe it's for selfish reasons. Maybe it's for others, to get ahead of others so much so that we are hurting other people. Or maybe we are just for the fame and popularity and the power that goes with whatever we do. And then we forget that we are all called to be the light of the nation. And so we pray for this grace and blessing, my little brothers and sisters. St. John the Baptist is a very beautiful and powerful image. We see the triumph of God's grace, especially the grace of humility, in his person and in his mission. So let us pray for this, that this humility, which enables us to love more, may also be victorious in each of our lives. That we may continue to do what we have to do with all humility, always getting in touch with that dimension deep inside that would say, I am not worthy, but at the same time, responding to the call to be the light of the nations. May we always have this grace to be truly humble, so we can be truly loving.